All right. Listen, we've been having fun this weekend learning about our independence, why we're proud to be Americans, why we love this freedom that we enjoy. And you know, sometimes we get a little bit spoiled and just sort of enjoying the blessings of liberty, but not being prepared to do our part to preserve that freedom and preserve that liberty. So I appreciate you giving me the chance to teach a little bit on that tonight. As I mentioned this morning, I'm always surprised when a pastor is willing to give up their pulpit to a Texas politician. I'm actually a recovering politician, which means that every Tuesday night I go to a meeting and I get up and say, "Hi, I'm Rick. I'm a recovering politician. I'm now, let's see, 4 years clean off the ballot." Okay, just so you know. So things are good in the greenhouse. My wife is very happy about that. I think we are a little bit cynical about politicians. I know when I got sworn into office, I'm standing there on the Texas House floor and I'm taking the oath of office, and I don't know. I mean, I guess it was because my pastor was there with me. Maybe I don't know. I had my pastor there, and I had one kid at the time. My dad and mom, everybody's there. That night, I have this dream that I get to heaven, and my pastor and I arrive at the exact same time, and St. Peter's showing us around. He says, you know, takes us to this little shack, this little one bedroom deal. I mean, it's nothing but a little cot, little desk. I mean, nothing you would expect in heaven. And says to my pastor, "Brother Dickie, this will be your home in heaven." And I'm thinking, man, if the preacher's getting that, I'm in trouble. But we go around a corner, and it's a big, huge mansion, gold pillars, all that fancy stuff you dream about for heaven. And he says, "Rick, this will be your home in heaven." I said, wait, why does that good and holy man get that shack, and I get this beautiful mansion? He said, "Well, Rick, you just got here. You don't know how it works." He said, "We got all the preachers up here we want. You're the first politician to ever make it." So we thought we'd do something a little different. So listen, I know we're cynical. I think the reason we're cynical is because, honestly, we're tired of politicians. We don't want politicians. A politician is always thinking about the next election. Here's what we want. We want patriots, because a patriot is thinking about the next generation. You see? It's that biblical mindset of leaving something for your grandchildren, making sure that you're not robbing from them, but you're in fact preserving and building up something that you can pass on to them. So that's the mindset that we want to get into. I have to admit, when you get involved in politics, certainly you get an elected office, sometimes your head swells a little bit. I was pretty young. I was 26 when I ran for office and ended up getting elected. And man, my head started swelling. I started thinking I was really somebody, you know. And how many of you know when your pride gets out of hand, God will find a way to humble you? Anybody out there? Three other people in the room have been humbled. Thank y'all very much for raising your hand. So anyway, I get elected, and I'm setting things up back home. You know, I'm putting my desk together and my bookshelf, and I got my district office there, and we're getting everything set up, and I'm all excited. I'm back in the back office working on my desk and organizing. I hear somebody come in the front door, and I'm the only one there. So, you know, I'm the new state rep in town. I'm supposed to be busy and important. So before he could get back to my office, I grabbed the phone off my desk. No, I can't see you Thursday. I'm booked. No, I'm booked next Thursday as well. Tell you what, 2 weeks from Thursday, I'll meet you right here in my office. All right, yep, okay, fine. Put the phone down. This guy's made his way through my office. He's standing right in front of my desk. I put the phone down. I said, "Yes, sir, can I help you?" He said, "No, I'm just here to hook up that there phone for you, son." So, for the young people in the room, back then phones had these cords, and they went into the wall, and it's a whole different system. But anyway, yeah, so God will humble you when you need to be humbled. All right, let me just tell you. So when I talk about pride, all right, there's a difference in that sinful individual pride and the pride that, when I say I'm proud to be an American, says that there's a value system here worth fighting for. And that's what we talked about this morning, is that foundation, sort of the basic beliefs of the American system that make it worth fighting for. Tonight, I want to give you some examples of why we fight, people that have fought for that freedom, and hopefully encourage you to find your place at the wall so that we can rebuild that wall. As I mentioned this morning out of Nehemiah, arise and rebuild the walls that we may no longer be a reproach. If you think about cities back then in the Old Testament, if your outer walls were destroyed, your city would be run over. Today, when the foundation is destroyed, your city or your nation will be run over. So for us, just like in Nehemiah's day, we see the foundations being destroyed. It's our job, just like they did, every member of the culture. Didn't matter if you were a perfume maker, if you were actually knew how to build a wall, didn't matter what your profession was, everyone had a role to play. Everyone had a place at the wall, and it was their duty to help preserve it. So tonight, I want you thinking about that. What's my role? What is God calling me to do to preserve freedom for the next generation? And as part of that, I want to take you back to 9/11 in New York City. And maybe initially you're thinking of a particular 9/11 in New York City. The one that I would like to talk to you about is not the most recent one. This 9/11 in New York City was all the way back 239 years ago to 1776. And New York City is the focal point of the Revolutionary War. This is just a few months after the Declaration of Independence. George Washington is finally turning that ragtag army into a genuine fighting force. The British have attacked us in New York. They've defeated us at Long Island. They push Washington back. He's kind of dug in, and he's trying to figure out what to do next. He doesn't know where the British are going to attack next. He doesn't know how many British troops there are. He doesn't know where their fortifications are. This is all information that he needs if he's going to keep from losing all of New York City. So the only way he's going to find out those answers is George Washington needs a spy. But this is at the beginning of the war. Now, later on, we get Lafayette, and we get his incredible spies like James Armistead that I told you about this morning, the great black patriot that set up Yorktown for our victory. But in 1776, it was a different world. So you may think of spy. I know when I say the word spy, I immediately think of these, you know, well-dressed, smooth-talking super soldiers. You know, these guys that can... I mean, they can accomplish any mission impossible. They can run down the side of a mile-high building, no problem. And they can, if they don't have a gun, no problem. They'll kill you with a toothpick, paperclip, magazine. Doesn't matter, right? And all the while, they keep their cool. You know, I mean, even after the fight scene and everything, they can still order that martini shaken, not stirred. I mean, they're cool, you know? That's a spy today. Not so in 1776. There was no Jason Bourne. There was no Mitch Rapp. None of those guys existed. In fact, if you were a spy in 1776, man, you were the lowest of the low. You were the dregs of society. You were a hired gun, and you would be hung up on capture because no one trusted you. So George Washington could not trust this mission to that type of a spy. He needed an officer. He needed someone that he could trust, but he would not demand it of them, because here's the deal. If you volunteered as a spy back then and you got caught, it didn't matter what kind of good you were doing for which side. Your reputation was ruined, your name, your legacy, your family, all of it ruined. So he wanted someone that would be willing to volunteer, not someone he had to demand. He needed an officer to step up and do that. So the scene before us, as we go back in our time machine to September 11, 1776, is in the tent of Colonel Tom Knowlton. And he's trying to convince one of those officers to volunteer. He's trying to convince them someone to be a spy. He says, look, we need this. The general needs this. The cause needs this. This is very important. No one's willing to do it. In fact, one of the guys speaks up and says, I am willing to be shot in battle. I'm not willing to be hung like a dog. There's no honor in being a spy. Colonel Knowlton gives up. He turns to leave. He's going to go tell the general that he's failed. And as he's leaving, just like Scott was describing that young lady, this young man steps forward from the door of that tent and says, I will undertake the mission. He's the youngest man there, 21 years old, youngest officer there. And he volunteers for the mission. Now, the reason he was at the door of the tent is because he was late to the meeting. He was actually sick. He was ill with a fever. And yet he still volunteers for the mission. Now, to really understand what's happening in this tent, you got to understand who we're talking about. These are Colonel Tom Knowlton's Rangers. These are the original Special Forces for America, the team that Washington had put together. Now, I know that's hard to picture or comprehend in the Revolutionary War, to think of Rangers in the Revolutionary War. So I don't know if this side's going to be able to see it or not, but here's the only way to capture this, at least in my weird mind. I want you to think of Chuck Norris, but with a ponytail, all right? So we're back to Mel Gibson. Scott, I was thinking about you when I put that together. Okay, so we've got a tent full of Chuck Norrises with ponytails, all right? Special Forces back then, and the kid that steps forward is none other than Nathan Hale. 21 years old, recently graduated from Yale. He studied for the ministry and decided to go be a teacher for a couple years before he went into full-time ministry. He's teaching in a small town of New London, Connecticut. And the war breaks out, Lexington and Concord. We talked about Lexington this morning. A lot of towns, when that happened, had town hall meetings to say, how are we going to respond? What's our community going to do as a result of this? And that happened in Nathan Hale's hometown, where he was a teacher. He goes to the town hall meeting. He's 19 years old at the time of this meeting. He stands up at the meeting at 19 years old, and he says, we should take up arms, we should march to war, and we should not lay down those arms until we've achieved independence. Now, at that time, independence had not even been spoken in public in that community. But Nathan Hale shakes his community from their slumber. He shakes the hands of each of his students, prays with his students, and marches off to war. Year and a half later, he finds himself outside that tent of Colonel Knowlton, having volunteered for this impossible mission. Buddy of his named Captain William Hall walks outside with him and says, you gotta back out. You can't do this. Look, you were a great speaker in college. You were a great orator, but you're a terrible liar. You'll never make it as a spy. You got to be able to lie to be a good spy. There's no way you're going to be able to do this. He says, this is an impossible mission. There is no honor in it. You're going to ruin your family's name. He says that Nathan Hale responded to him. He writes about this later. He said Nathan Hale responded to him saying, the general needs me. The cause needs me. There is honor whenever freedom is at stake. I will answer the call of duty, and I will take on this mission. So he dresses up as a teacher, gets his diploma, sneaks across enemy lines, and acts like he's a teacher looking for work. He's mapping out the fortifications of the British. He's getting all the information that Washington needs, where they're moving, the troop movements, all of those things. He stuffs all this information in his boot. He tries to sneak back across enemy lines, and he's captured. The evidence is right there on his person. He's immediately sentenced to death. He's going to be hung the next morning. And so that night, as he's thinking about what's happened, he's failed the general. He's failed the mission. He's failed the cause he loves so much. And he's trying to decide, what can I do? What's left for me to do for this cause that I love? He asked for a Bible. They refuse. He asked for a member of the clergy. They refuse. They finally give him some paper and pen, and he's able to write back home. And as he's writing those letters back home, he purposes within his heart to do the one thing left that he can do for the cause that he loves. Next morning, they march him out. They're going to take his life. And as they get him out there ready to take his life, a crowd has gathered to watch the hanging. And they give him a chance for his last few words. Remember, Captain Hall said he was a great orator back in college. And so he begins to give a speech about the cause of freedom. He steps forth and uses his voice to defend the cause of liberty. And he begins to quote from Joseph Addison's Cato and all these things that he understood from college. And the British start heckling him. The soldiers are heckling him. They say, man, you're wasting your life. You're going to throw your life away for the American cause? What a waste. What a waste of your life. And Nathan Hale uses those amazing words that would be repeated over and over and over again. At 21 years old, he says, I only regret that I have but one life to give for my country. His life would be taken at that moment, but those words would be repeated over and over and over again. They inspired a generation to sign up and fight for the American cause. And generation after generation of Americans have repeated those words and been inspired. He did more for the cause of liberty with that speech before his death than he ever could have done by getting that intelligence back to George Washington. One life to give. Friends, I don't care if you're 8 or you're 80. You and I have but one life to give. And tonight I'm asking you, for what will you give your one life? What are you willing to invest yourself in? What is God calling you to? What is the expectation on your life and the purpose for which you have been called to serve God, the impact that you're going to have? Our nation's been very, very blessed from the time of Nathan Hale through this current generation and patriots like Michael Murphy and others. Generations have always been willing to give their one life, lay down their lives for our freedom, lay down their lives that we may live in freedom. Of course, the Bible tells us there's no greater love than that you're willing to lay down your life for your friend, or in this case, your family or your country. And it's our job to honor that. The Bible tells us to render honor unto whom honor is due. I think those that serve us in the military are our first responders. Those that are willing to lay down their lives for us deserve that honor, don't they? And I'll be honest with you, I struggle with this. How do you properly honor that kind of sacrifice? I mean, I teach my kids to every time they see somebody in uniform, run up and shake their hand, say thank you for your service. It's a small thing. It takes us about 6 hours to get from the entrance to the airport to our actual gate by the time they stop every soldier and every sailor and everybody that comes through. But here's the thing. I was wondering, okay, how do you do more than that? It's one thing to thank them, but how do you really honor their sacrifice? And then I saw this movie, Saving Private Ryan. How many of y'all ever saw the movie Saving Private Ryan? I know I'm dating myself here, but there was a moment in this movie towards the end of the movie, and the movie's about this kid, Private Ryan, 19 years old. His brothers have all been killed in action. He's the last surviving son for this family, and the military figures this out, and so he's behind enemy lines. They want to find him. They want to get him home to his family since all of his brothers have already been killed in action. And so Tom Hanks plays the character of Captain Miller. And Captain Miller's job is to take his small team, find Private Ryan, and get him out of the battle and get him home. And so the movie is actually following this team. And one by one, the guys on this team keep getting killed. They keep laying down their life for this kid, this Private Ryan, that they don't even know. And so all through the movie, they're sacrificing for him. And then finally, at the end of the movie, they find him. They're just about to get him out and get him home, and Captain Miller gets killed. But just before Captain Miller dies, this Private Ryan, this 19-year-old kid who has just figured out what they've done for him, Captain Miller grabs this kid and he pulls him in real close, and with his last breath, he said two words, not just to Private Ryan, but to every one of us. He said, "Earn this." Think about that. Earn this. And then that scene morphed, as only Hollywood could do it, from that young Private Ryan at 19 years old to 50, 60 years later, an elderly Private Ryan has gone back to visit, and he's standing over the grave of Captain Miller. And two generations later, he kneels down at that grave and he says to Captain Miller, "Tell me I'm a good man. Tell me I've lived a good life. Tell me I've lived a life worthy of the sacrifice that you made for me." Earn this. Are we earning the freedom that we've been given? Are we honoring that sacrifice? I love the way Lincoln said it at Gettysburg. In fact, at the end of Saving Private Ryan, this is quoted in one of the letters. "It's from these honored dead that we take increased devotion to the cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion, that we highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and the government of the people, by the people, for the people shall not perish from the earth." How do you honor the sacrifice? Back up. An increased devotion to the cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. So all of these have sacrificed for us. They've died for our freedom. How do we show an increased devotion to the cause for which they were willing to give so much? First thing is, we've got to know what that was. What did they give their one life for? When they laid it down for us, it wasn't, as we said this morning, just the flag. It was what the flag stands for. It was this concept of American exceptionalism. And I know some people don't like this phrase, American exceptionalism. Hey, oh, that's, you know, you're bragging if you say American exceptionalism. You're saying we're better than everybody. Look, I'm a Texan, all right? I know a little something about bragging, you know, all right? We Texans tend to brag just a little bit. I mean, in fact, when I first got elected, I was visiting with, well, it was before I got elected, actually. I was visiting with at the time, Governor George Bush. And I'm sitting in his office. I'm doing this interview about, I did a documentary on your former governor, President Reagan. And I was defending Reagan's economic policies and a bunch of these things and his patriotism. And first I'd gone to D.C. and I interviewed Trent Lott and Dick Cheney and a bunch of guys that had been part of the of Congress whenever the tax cuts were made in 81, all this, but in too much detail. Anyway, I'm interviewing Dick Cheney. This is back in the early 90s. I had no idea Dick Cheney was going to become vice president. I had no idea he was going to turn into Darth Vader. I didn't know any of that stuff. And which I'm actually a Star Wars fan. I like Darth Vader. I mean, if Dick Cheney had just breathed a little bit like Darth Vader, you know, that would have been kind of cool to have a vice president like that. But anyway, so I'm interviewing Dick Cheney, and he's got this white phone on his desk, and this phone has a halo on it. I'd never seen one of those. I said, "Secretary Cheney," he was Secretary of Defense at the time of the interview, "Secretary Cheney, what's with the phone?" He said, "Well, Rick, that's a direct line to God." I said, "You got to be kidding. Can I use it?" He said, "Yeah, you can use it, but it costs $500 a minute if you make the calls." Said, "All right." Made the call, paid him, got back to Texas. I'm interviewing George W. Bush, governor of Texas. While I'm in the middle of the interview with him, I notice his white phone with a halo. I said, "Governor, could I use your direct line to God?" He said, "Well, sure, Rick, but you got to pay me back. That thing's $5 a minute." I said, wait, Governor. I was with the Secretary of Defense. Man, that's all the states, the whole nation, $500 a minute. You're governor of one state telling me it's only $5. He said, "Boy, you've forgotten where you are." He said, "This is Texas. It's God's country. Local call if you make it from right here in Texas." So, now that is bragging, all right? So that's not what I'm talking about when I say American exceptionalism, because American exceptionalism is absolutely true. But here's what you got to understand whenever we say American exceptionalism. Maybe if we replace the word, it will help. Instead of exceptionalism, let's say extraordinary, because that's what it means. Beyond ordinary, beyond the normal, beyond what any other nation has been able to do. That's what American exceptionalism is. And to help my case that it's not bragging, just remember that the phrase American exceptionalism was given to us by a Frenchman. You think a Frenchman would give us a name if it was just bragging? No. De Tocqueville comes over here and he's like, "Man, these Americans have already got things that no nation has ever enjoyed before. What is it about the American way of life and values and system that is so unique?" And he gave us a great quote. And by the way, his book, we call it Democracy in America. It was originally called The Republic of the United States of America. Why? Because we're not a democracy, we're a republic. That's a whole other topic. Okay, so here's what he said. "The position of the Americans is quite exceptional. It may be believed that no people will ever be placed in a similar one. We have an exceptional opportunity that has produced exceptional results." More, we talked about all that this morning. What I don't understand is, Why is it that with a nation with the most incredible results in the history of the world, why do our leaders keep looking to Europe and saying, we want to be more like them? Why do we say, wait a minute, we've got the most incredible, most fair system of law other than any other. In fact, Benjamin Franklin said that our system of government was the worst other than every other one. Right? You with me on that? Which means there's no perfect system this side of heaven. But of all the systems out there, ours is absolutely the best. And yet now our Supreme Court justices are saying, no, we're going to follow international law, not the United States Constitution. We wouldn't even base a nation on the United States Constitution. That's what some of our justices have said. We're taking things like our economic policy and we're modeling Europe and bringing it into our nation, even though we had such a better economic outcome than they did, destroying our economy with that. We're now adopting all these social policies based on what Europe has done. So we're trying to model other nations that haven't had anywhere near the success we have. Just take health care for instance. We go for socialism in health care because we want to be like other nations. Yet, look at the difference between us and other nations. Breast cancer mortality is 52% higher in Germany than in the U.S. and 88% higher in the United Kingdom. Socialist countries with socialist medicine. Why would we adopt that when we had such a better result? How about the men? Prostate cancer mortality is 604% higher in the U.K. and 457% higher in Norway. Where would you want to get sick? Somewhere else or here in the United States before we adopted European socialism for all of these things we're trying to, why would we get away from our formula that's produced great results and move to formulas that are not? Think about the economy. America's 4% of the world in population, yet we have 32% of the wealth. Now, some people say, oh, that's not fair. Well, why is it that we have 32% of the wealth? It's because of free enterprise. It's because of that pursuit of happiness that our system allows for that competition and that reward of the individual work ethic and sweat equity that allows us to produce more wealth than anyone else in history. So why are we moving away from these things? Oh, yeah, by the way, people always say, well, yeah, but that's the 1%. They've got all the wealth. Those living below the poverty level in the United States are more likely to have a telephone, a television, an air conditioner, an automobile, eat more red meat, and have more living space than. Now, this is those living below the poverty level in the U.S., you might expect me to say, are more likely to have all those things than those living below the poverty level in Europe. No. Those living below the poverty level in the U.S. are more likely to have all those things than the middle class in Europe. All right? So those living the worst in our country are better off than those that are supposed to be doing good in other nations. There's something different. In fact, it's so different. This is what Jefferson said. The comparisons of our government with those of Europe are like a comparison of heaven and hell. That's a pretty big difference, right? Now, back to this question of bragging, right? Notice that he did not say the comparison of our people. He's comparing the systems, the political and economic structures, the foundations. It's not that we are better, you're not better, I'm not better. But the system itself, these values, because they're based on biblical concepts of property rights and free enterprise, these basic biblical concepts, that's the difference between heaven and hell. And those are the things that we have a responsibility to protect because they absolutely work. This pursuit of happiness in America has produced more economic prosperity and choices and all those things than any in the history of the world. But it's not just money, it's not just power. We're also the most benevolent nation in the history of the world. Every time another nation is in trouble, who's there first to help? The American people. Muslim nations that have tsunamis and everything else that happens, who's there first? The Christian nation of America is the first ones there to help. That's the kind of nation we are because of where we came from and the foundation upon which we were built. But we've forgotten those things. And Reagan said, if we forget what we did, we won't know who we are. America has an identity crisis right now. We don't know who we are. We don't know what we're about. So we're floundering about trying to find something to believe in. It's the old Poison song. Give me something to believe in. Somebody from the 80s, please say amen. All right. Anyway, we're trying to find something to believe in, something that we can actually have some faith in, and we've forgotten that the foundations of this country are bedrock principles that we can have some faith in. We've lost our vision. The Bible tells us where there's no vision, the people perish. I'm not normally a Message Bible kind of guy. I think you could actually, you know, read the Message Bible and find probably a, like Tim Hawkins says, the recipe for a Rice Krispie treat or something in there. I mean, it's just amazing what you, Jesus is really cool. I mean, it's weird. Anyway, however, I do like this version from the Message on Proverbs 29:18. If people can't see what God is doing, they stumble all over themselves. Man, is that not what we're doing in America right now? We're stumbling all over ourselves because we don't have the vision of where we came from and what these guys gave us and what they did for us to be free. Let me take you back to how difficult it was to put this thing in place. Because sometimes we think, oh, it was just popular, right? I mean, everybody came to, why can't it be like the founding era where everybody just comes together and it's unanimous? It's never been like that. It will never be like that this side of heaven. But back then, it was very, very close. We almost lost independence. In fact, they were having the debate on June 7th, 1776, which was a month before we actually declare our independence. And Richard Henry Lee gets up and he makes the motion. He says that these United Colonies are and of right ought to be free and independent states. And he makes the motion. John Adams seconds the motion. The guy taking the journal, after he writes their names down, he scratches their names out because that is treason. They have just committed treason in the Continental Congress. He says if this is still in the journal, King George is going to lop off their heads first. So they start to debate it. They debate it for a while. They you know how politics can be. They go back and forth, lots of talk, no action. Finally, one of the guys has had enough. Sitting back over here in the corner, you may not be familiar with him. He's tired of all the talk. He's ready for some action. His name was Larry. You may not have ever heard of him before, but he stands up and says, guys, it is time to get her done. Didn't know that, did you? All right, his name wasn't really Larry. It was the guy we talked about this morning, John Witherspoon, but he did a 1776 version of Get Her Done. They had another guy, John Dickinson, who said, the people are not ripe for revolution. And so Witherspoon gets up and he says, they're not only ripe, but rotting. Let's take the vote. And he pushes them for the vote. And the vote for independence fails. Three states said no. It was South Carolina, Delaware, and Pennsylvania. Delaware was actually a tie. 1-1 tie. The third delegate was missing. A guy named Caesar Rodney. Thomas McKean was the yes vote. Thomas McKean knew Rodney was a patriot. He would vote for independence, but he had been had to go back home to Delaware, had some things he had to deal with there. So he gets one of his riders, and he sends this rider back to Delaware. Says, you got to find Caesar Rodney. Tell him if he doesn't get back to Philadelphia in time for the next vote, independence is not going to happen. The rider finds Rodney, tells Rodney he's got to get back immediately. Rodney jumps on his horse, rides all night long to get back to Philadelphia before the next vote. He's got cancer of the face. He's hitting branches, painful experience, scheduled for surgery in England, by the way. And if he goes and signs the Declaration of Independence, he's literally giving up his life because now he can't go back to England. So Caesar Rodney rides 80 miles on horseback. Now, howdy, Chuck. If you weren't here this morning, you don't get that. Sorry. Got to go get the CD, I guess. All right. Anyway, so he rides. Now, I know what you're thinking. 80 miles, man, what's the deal? That doesn't take very long. I mean, if my wife is driving, 80 miles is like 30 minutes. I mean, it's just not going to take very long. 80 miles on horseback, though, all night long. Gets there just in time, literally walks in as they're taking the vote. He casts a tie-breaking vote for Delaware. And that's why when you see you remember how we did the quarters? Each state got to do their own quarter. The Delaware quarter is actually Caesar Rodney making that midnight ride to save independence. So really cool story. You say, well, okay, so Rodney breaks the tie for Delaware. What happened to Pennsylvania? Pennsylvania had voted 4-3 against independence. But at the time they take this vote, apparently two of the guys either went to the bathroom at the wrong time or disappeared. I don't know what happened, but they went from 4-3 to 3-2. So two of the no votes weren't there. There's a lesson in that. When the opposition is not in the room, take the vote. That's the time to take the vote. Okay, so happens in politics all the time. Anyway, so they go to, and South Carolina watches this happen. South Carolina had gone from 3-0 to flipping it to being 3-4 independent. So I tell you all that just so you know, it's always a close battle. Rarely do you have a unanimous holding hands and singing kumbaya. It takes a battle. It takes a fight to preserve freedom and independence for our nation. Now, one thing I want to mention about South Carolina, a lot of times we think that it was all a bunch of old guys that did this for us. South Carolina had two guys out of their three-member delegation that were 26 years old. All right, 26 years old. Thomas Hayward and Thomas Lynch. 26 years old, and they're signing the Declaration of Independence. I want you to think about that for a second. They're not very far along in their life, and yet they're going to be willing to give their life. See, we've lost this idea of young people getting engaged early. We've bought this idea in our culture that you got to be 30, 40, 50 years old before God can use you to make a difference. So young people that are here tonight, pay attention the next few minutes. Timothy tells us, don't let anyone look down on you because you're young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, and impurity. A realize that God can use you now. America is a perfect example of that. I mean, even the Declaration of Independence was written by Thomas Jefferson at the age of only 33. He pens those amazing words that would change the world at 33 years old. William Barrett Travis at the Alamo leads our troops in one of the most famous battles in the history of the world. He was 26 years old at that time. Benjamin Rush graduates from Princeton at 14 years old and goes on to become one of the most famous doctors in American history. Andrew Jackson, you know him as a president. Do you realize that he fought for America and was captured and served time as a POW at the age of 14? He was fighting for our independence at the time and was willing to die for that. Sybil Ludington, Scott got me thinking about her this morning when he was telling the story of Betty. What's her? Zane, that's it. Zane. Inside joke. Never mind. Okay, so Sybil Ludington, 16 years old, and she rides 40 miles in one night as a midnight rider to muster the Minutemen there in Carmel, New York. 40 miles, three times as long as Paul Revere. Much tougher conditions, all of those things in order to get in. 16 years old, think about that today. John Quincy Adams, this guy is amazing. At only 8 years old, he's out there doing musket drills with the Massachusetts Minutemen. At 8 years old, that would be like my youngest son going out and taking target practice with the Navy SEALs. You know what I'm saying? I mean, that's the same comparison we're talking about here. It's just amazing when I think about what John Quincy Adams did. So Adams also goes on and gets his first diplomatic appointment at 11 years old, then again at 14, and travels around the world representing his country. Here's the difference. Back then in early America, we had high expectations for our young people. Today it's low expectations. We don't expect anything. We expect you to play Xbox in mom and dad's house till you're 30 years old. They had a strong work ethic. They were willing to put in the time, give up the movies and the games, or at least reduce how much they have of that entertainment me mentality and work hard so that they could be used and make a big difference. Folks, we've got to get back in that mentality. That's why we do Patriot Academy, raising up that next generation, teaching them how to make a difference. If you could sit in the gallery of one of these state capitals where we have Patriot Academy and watch these young people passionately articulate the issues of the day, learning how to win, not just to know what to do, but know how to do it effectively and win, you'd be so encouraged with where we are as a nation with this young people, this remnant that's coming up. But see, here's what happens. You have guys like these pastors from the Revolutionary War. In fact, John Adams was asked one time, who's most responsible for the American Revolution? And they said, sure, Washington and some of these guys. But he said the pastors are the ones that were sowing the seeds of liberty that reaped the Revolutionary War. Without these guys, he named all these guys, we would have never had a revolution. And each of these pastors that are up here, each of them was mentoring a young man in their life. Guys like Patrick Henry, who says that he learned how to speak and learned how to be a great orator as a result of learning under the pastorship of the Reverend Samuel Davies, John Adams, Benjamin Rush. All these guys had mentors that were breathing into them, sowing into them, giving them destiny for a future. That's what we've got to do today. We've got to be willing to tell these young people they've got an inheritance in America that God is preparing them to lead. This guy here, you probably never heard of Ben Hooper before. When he was a little kid, if you didn't know who your dad was, you were ostracized. You were put down. You were ridiculed. In fact, even as a little kid in the foothills of East Tennessee, other parents would not even let their kids play with little Ben Hooper. They said, "Oh, what's a child like that doing in our neighborhood?" As if he had anything to do with his own birth. He gets into school, 6 years old. No other kid would even talk to him or play with him. He would have to sit in his little desk and study it at lunch and on breaks. It's like that all the way through the first 6 years of his education until he's 12 years old. And then when he's 12 years old, this new preacher shows up in their small town. And almost immediately, he starts hearing about this preacher. How this guy, when he's with you, it's like you're the only person on earth, and he doesn't judge you for where you came from. He talks to you about where you're going. And he gets all excited, and he says, you know, I'm going to go check this out. And Ben Hooper shows up at church for the first time in his life. But he did something unique. He got there late and sat in the back. He didn't want anybody to know he was there. He didn't want to make a big deal out of it. He stays for the service, and then he sneaks out a little bit early before anybody could see him. But for one moment and the first time in his life, Ben Hooper caught a glimpse of hope. John Maxwell says, when there's hope in the future, there's power in the present. So little Ben came back the next Sunday and the next Sunday and the next Sunday. Every week he got there late. Every week he left early. About the sixth or seventh Sunday, he's sitting in the back of that church. And he's listening to this sermon, and the sermon is almost like it's aimed right at Ben Hooper. It's like this preacher is up there, and there's a banner behind the preacher that says, for you, little Ben Hooper, of unknown heritage, there's hope in your future. And Ben's getting all excited, man. He's so into the message. Before he knows it, the service is over. He jumps up. He's going to run out like he had in Sunday's past, but now all of a sudden the crowd's there and he can't get out. And he doesn't know what to do. He's trying to make his way through the crowd, and suddenly he feels his hand on his shoulder, and this booming voice asks the question that had been on the minds of everyone in that church for 12 years. Whose boy are you? Instantly, all that shame comes back to Ben Hooper, and he drops his head down, and all of a sudden that hand spins him around, reaches under his chin, lifts up his head, and he's looking up into the eyes of that young minister. Everyone in the church has stopped. It's deathly quiet. They're all listening. And that young preacher all of a sudden starts to get a little bit of a grin, and then he gets a huge smile, and he says, "Oh, well, I know whose boy you are. Why, the resemblance, it's unmistakable, son. You are a child of God." He said, that's quite an inheritance you got there, boy. He said, "What an inheritance." He said, "Son, now go and see to it that you live up to it." And Ben Hooper, many years later, said, "That was the day I was elected governor of the state of Tennessee. Later, the people just reelected me, but that day I discovered my inheritance and my purpose in life." Folks, we have a generation that needs to be told that they have an amazing inheritance, both as an American and the freedom that we have, and also as a child of God and the purpose that God has on their life. It is our job to mentor them and to teach them and to inspire them and show them what God has for them. They have one life to give, just like you and I. And if we'll raise them up to understand that inheritance, then they can change this world for Christ and they can bring our nation back. Can I just tell you that the things that we would like to see happen in terms of restoring our liberty and our biblical freedoms in America, it is not going to happen overnight. All right, we did not get in this mess in 1 year. One presidential election is not going to save America. This is a generational fight. It's going to take a generation of Christians again being salt and light. I'll give you a perfect example of this. This guy right here is John Quincy Adams. John Quincy Adams is the only guy in history to be president of the United States and then go home and run for Congress. So can you imagine being the man on one end of Pennsylvania Avenue and then going and running for Congress and being one of today, 535, when you count the House and the Senate? He was willing to do that. Why? He had one issue. People talk about one-issue candidates. This guy was a one-issue candidate. You know what it was? Anybody know? Give me a guess. Ending slavery. Exactly right. He wants to get rid of slavery. So he goes into Congress. He files bill after bill, week after week, month after month. Small problem. It's a pro-slavery Congress. He's not getting anywhere. He's beating his head against the wall. He's not accomplishing anything. 13 years of fighting to end slavery with zero accomplishments. All right? Now, we get depressed after one election cycle. "Well, we didn't change the world. I guess the system doesn't work anymore." And we give up and we go home. David Barton and I always joke about when Christians get involved in politics, if we win, they go home and don't get involved. If we lose, they go home and don't get involved. It's like one battle. That's all we're good for. Man, we've forgotten our duty. We've forgotten that it's incrementalism. It takes generations to change things. John Quincy Adams didn't forget that. He just keeps coming back week after week, month after month, year after year. 13 years into it, this reporter comes to him and says, "Man, what is your problem? Why are you doing this? You're not getting anywhere. In fact, the Congress passed the John Quincy Adams gag order that said, Adams, you can talk about anything you want, but you can't even talk about ending slavery anymore." He was so smart, he managed to get himself censured so that there would be a trial where at the censure trial, he could get up and talk about ending slavery. I love it. But he keeps losing. This reporter says, "Man, you're wasting my time. You're wasting your time. You're wasting Congress's time. Why are you doing this?" John Quincy Adams gave a response that I hope you'll remember and you'll adopt if you really want to see change in America. He said, "Duty is ours. Results are God's." Duty is ours. Results are God's. He said, "It's not my job to get the results. It's my job to do what God's called me to do, and I'm going to keep fighting." He fought for 4 more years, and he died on the floor of Congress. Literally dies in the Capitol. Actually died in the Speaker's chamber, in the Speaker's office. Fell over on the floor of Congress with a stroke and dies 3 days later. Never gets to see an end to slavery. Now, you might say, that guy wasted his life. What a waste. He had one life to give, and he threw it away and didn't accomplish what he wanted to accomplish because he never got to see an end to slavery. But for 1 2-year term, he served with a young man that he mentored, a young man that he kind of poured his heart into, a young man that he brought alongside him and he breathed some destiny into him, taught him everything that he could. In fact, this kid got so close to him that this kid was a pallbearer at John Quincy Adams' funeral. So the kid gets to learn from John Quincy Adams. John Quincy Adams dies. The kid goes home to run for re-election and gets defeated. Runs for another office, gets defeated. Runs for another office, gets defeated. Lose, lose, lose. Finally, 15 years later, this young kid wins an election. He's president of the United States. His name is Abraham Lincoln. And he takes the exact same three-step plan of John Quincy Adams and implements it. Friends, you have no idea. It's just like when you share the gospel. You have no idea. You're planting that seed. Somebody else, God's already got them in the wings. They're going to come water that seed. It's not your responsibility to get the results. It's your responsibility to do your duty. Duty is ours. Results are God's. I'm asking you to take your freedom serious. I'm asking you to get involved in your culture and get involved in your nation. I want to leave you with exactly what happened when the Declaration of Independence was signed, because we're actually doing this on the wrong weekend. Declaration was not signed on July 4th. Only two guys signed on July 4th, Secretary Thompson and the President, John Hancock. A month later, on August 2nd, so we're all going to gather for more barbecue on August 2nd, right? A month later, on August 2nd, they gather in Independence Hall to sign the Declaration. Now all of them are going to put their name on the dotted line. They voted for it back on July 2nd and July 4th. They sent it out to the world and told them what we were doing. But then they decided, you know what, it's important because of what we're pledging. We need to put our names on this document. They gathered in the room, and Benjamin Rush and John Adams exchanged letters later recounting what happened. They said that we believed when we walked in that room that we were signing our death warrant. We believed we were going to lay down our lives as a result of this. So it was kind of bittersweet. They're going to light the torch of freedom. They're going to birth a nation, but they're going to pay for it with their own lives. So they come into the room. No one says a word. Total silence. Secretary Thompson standing at the front of the room. He's got the Declaration laid out there with the silver inkwell and the two feathered pens. If you go to Independence Hall today, you can still see it there. And he begins to call them forward one by one to sign. He starts on his right with the delegation from New Hampshire. Josiah Bartlett of New Hampshire. Bartlett gets up. He comes forward. He takes the pen. He dips it in the ink. And in total silence, he signs the Declaration of Independence. Goes back and he sits down. One by one, they come. John Hart of New Jersey. Hart gets up, comes forward, takes a pen, dips it in the ink. You can hear that pen scratching along the Declaration of Independence. No one says a word until Elbridge Gerry is called forward. Now, Elbridge Gerry, most of you probably don't know who he was. He went on to become vice president. We don't talk about him much anymore. All you need to know about Elbridge Gerry is he's the smallest of the founders. He's a little bitty guy. He is not the towering 7-foot Thor-like figure that stands before you speaking this evening. What are you guys laughing at? Okay, seriously, I'm a little guy. Elbridge Gerry was even smaller than me. So the little guy gets up, he comes forward, he takes a pen, he's about to sign. It's the most important political moment in the history of the world. And there's a big guy in the back of the room by the name of Colonel Benjamin Harrison. Now, he's huge. I mean, Harrison was big. He could have been a middle linebacker for, well, probably big enough for USC. He wasn't big enough for Texas. But anyway, he's a big guy. All right. And the big guy from the back of the room hollers out to the little man up there just about to sign. He says, "I shall have a great advantage over you, Mr. Gerry, when we're hung for what we're now doing. By the size and great weight of my body, well, I'm going to be dead in a minute or two. By the lightness of yours, you're going to dance in the air for an hour or more before you finally die." True story, you can laugh. It's real. Okay, I tell you that because it's funny, but I also tell you because of this. That tells you that those men knew. They knew what they were doing. Benjamin Rush said that after his little joke, everybody laughed real hard, and then it got deathly quiet as it dawned on them. He's right. We're going to lay down our lives for what we're about to do. Do I believe in this enough? Do I believe in these values enough to lay down my life? One by one they came. They took that pen, they dipped it in the ink, and they signed beneath that amazing final sentence. It says, "In support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor." They didn't just have a rally and sign a petition, folks. They signed and then they gave their lives, fortunes, and sacred honor. Many of them did not survive to enjoy the freedom they birthed for us. Some of the wives gave their lives in order for us to have freedom. Elizabeth Lewis was at her home when they came for Frances Lewis, the signer. They fire a cannonball at her as she stands on the front porch, refusing to give up her home. Cannonball literally hits the porch right between her legs, goes between her legs, and she still will not back down. They had to drag her off the porch, throw her in prison. She died because of the maltreatment that happened there. Signer after signer gave everything, some of them dying in debtor's prison. The sacrifice was real. And I'm here to tell you, if this freedom is going to survive, your sacrifice is about to get real. You've got to be willing to give of your life, your time, your fortune, your money, and your sacred honor, willing to stand up and speak truth. Friends, our nation is depending on you. Each and every one of you has a role to play. God's given us such a gift to live in this country. It's not just about America. The world is depending on us. Christians all over the world need us. Israel needs us. Folks, we have got to stand up and take our nation back. Would you be willing to give? Would you be willing to sacrifice for your country? Are you willing to get involved and do your part? You're not asked to do much. A little bit of your time, folks. A few hours a week. A little bit of your income and just the willingness to speak truth. I'm so thankful for this church giving me the chance to come and share with you the encouragement of your words and the things we visited about out there at the table. Now take it and do something with it. Don't forget, duty is ours, results are God's. Would you bow your heads with me? Lord, thank you. Thank you for this time. Thank you for the fellowship that's going to happen here in a few minutes, Lord. And I just pray you'd knit the hearts of this congregation. Lord, that you would bring this church together to continue to be salt and light. I pray you would expand their influence in this city, in this state, and our nation. Lord, that you would raise up young people right here out of C3 Church that would lead this country in the next generation. Young people with a passion for you, that they would take your word, they would apply it in movies that they go make. Lord, that they would apply it in schools that they go lead as educators, that they would apply it as business people, that they would apply it in politics, that they would absolutely take your word and apply it in every single area of this culture. Thank you for pastors that get this, Lord, that are leading a church that will influence the country. I just thank you for everyone here, Father. Bless our time tonight. Thank you for the salvation that you give us. Thank you for the victory that you give us. Thank you for the peace that we can have in knowing that you are sovereign. Let us do our duty and leave the results to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.